From our weekend. So let me see if anything is projecting here. Okay, great. So my name is Daniel Cono Ramos. I am a scientist at Yale University, and my lab is interested in understanding how the brain forms and functions. Now, we don't do our studies in brains. We do our studies in a tiny animal. It's this worm here. It's called C. elegans. It's not that big. It's about the size of the accent in my last name. And if you're interested in understanding how scientists like me can use model organisms to make fundamental discoveries of impact in biology and medicine, I invite you to visit and see my other TED Talk, to visit my lab website, or to follow me via Twitter. Today, I'm going to be telling you instead about a nonprofit organization that I helped create 7 years ago called Ciencia Puerto Rico. So I am a scientist. I'm one of the first people in my community to become a scientist. And I'm frequently asked, how is it that you became interested in science? And what do scientists do? Why are you working in a worm? And I choose to answer that question by saying that we're all born scientists. Every single person here in this audience was once a scientist. I'm the father of triplets. These are my three daughters. This is their very first trip to the beach. This picture was taken here in Puerto Rico. And they are encountering for the first time a new mysterious substance called sand. And they're generating new knowledge about sand, much like scientists generate new knowledge about anything by experimenting. So they're grabbing the sand, they're breaking it up into little clumps in their fingers, they're eating it. And there are a few concepts here that I want to emphasize about how we generate new knowledge. One of them is that we generate new knowledge in a context-dependent fashion. So they're learning about sand because they're sitting at the beach on top of sand. If they were, say, sitting on top of a huge pile of leaves, they would be learning about leaves. And the reason that I know that is because I did the experiment. Here's the data. So they're on a huge pile of leaves, they're eating leaves. Now, so they're generating new knowledge in a context-dependent fashion, but sometimes we can learn from observation. So Keisani, my daughter in the middle here, she couldn't reach the leaves. So she observed that her sisters were gorging on leaves, and shortly after this picture was taken, started throwing up. So in that way, she learned from her sisters. And that's an important concept, because we're also capable of learning from each other. And the third concept that I want to emphasize about how we're all born scientists and about how we generate knowledge is the fact that although we learn in a context-dependent fashion, what we learn, we can apply widely. So what they're learning here, they will apply to other contexts in which they encounter sand, not only that context. Similarly, what they learn here, they'll apply to other contexts in which they encounter leaves. This is a picture that I took a few weeks ago, and I'm happy to report that, in part to some better parenting on my part, and in part to their experiences, there was no leaf eating this time. So, by the way, do not repeat these experiments at home. These are done by professionals. So these three concepts are actually very important, and they were cornerstone in the creation of an online community for scientists called Ciencia Puerto Rico. Ciencia Puerto Rico is today the largest community for people interested in science in Puerto Rico anywhere. And it's one of the largest communities for Hispanic scientists in the world. It's actually, for that matter, it's one of the largest online scientific communities that exist right now in the world. It has over 6,500 registered members. There are thousands of scientists that are registered, many students and educators as well. We have mediated thousands of interactions and collaborations. We have over a million visits a month. And today I'd like to tell you first why. Why are there thousands of scientists that went into this website and registered, particularly because we all know that getting scientists to do anything is like herding cats. It's really hard. So why did they do it? And why should you care? Why does that add value to your life? Then I'd like to tell you about how. How is it that we can then leverage this resource to create new real-life initiatives that are impacting scientific education here in Puerto Rico? And I'm going to argue that the initiatives that we have done, which are mostly experimental, could transform the way that we teach science in Puerto Rico. And finally, I'd like to tell you about what. What can we learn from this community, which is actually a geographically dispersed but local community here in Puerto Rico, but there are lessons that can be widely applicable to any scientific community around the world. And I think, I'm going to argue, that the lessons that we have learned could change the way that scientists communicate with each other, and it could change the way in which scientists communicate with the public and impact scientific education. So why create a scientific community? So I'm going to use a three-step logical argument to justify that. The first one is that scientific literacy is the basis for any knowledge-based economy. What I mean by that is that economies used to be very dependent on natural resources, and they're increasingly becoming dependent on the knowledge produced by their citizens. In Puerto Rico, we're aspiring to be a knowledge-based economy. Many places in the world are aspiring to be knowledge-based economies. And cornerstone to that is scientific literacy. Now, so important is scientific literacy that I will argue that scientific literacy is to the 21st century what knowing what to read and write was to the 20th century. Much like if you lived in a country in which most people did not know how to read and write, that country will have a really hard time competing in a global economy. If you live in a place where most people are scientifically illiterate, it's going to be a really hard chore to create a knowledge-based economy. And scientists are key in creating the scientific literacy because scientists, the job of a scientist, my job is to produce knowledge and then to disseminate knowledge. Now, I want to emphasize that knowledge is not created in isolation. Knowledge is created in communities. Scientists have recognized this for hundreds of years. That's why they have had scientific communities, scientific societies. Now, one of the challenges is that for many places, including our own scientific Puerto Rican community, our community is geographically dispersed. Let me draw a page from my own experience to exemplify this. I was born and raised here in Puerto Rico, but I did my training, my PhD and my postdoctoral training in the US. My experience is not unique. Over 70% of the PhDs given to Puerto Ricans in the sciences are given in institutions outside of Puerto Rico. So that tells us that we are talking about a geographically dispersed community that's very rich in knowledge, but is spread out all over the world. So how can we identify those people? And while I was a postdoctoral fellow at Stanford University, with a group of colleagues, I conceptualized an idea of how we could create a space online where people could come in and self-identify. And we created this project of Ciencia Puerto Rico, which was very simple at the beginning. It was just a space, a database, where people could just put in their information. We were hoping that it would create a space for collaborations. To be frank with you, when I started this project, I was anticipating maybe 40 or 50 people were going to register. And I thought that if we got 40 or 50 people to register, that would have been a huge success. We had no budget for anything, but certainly no marketing budget. So it was all word of mouth. We launched this website in January 15th, 2006. By February, we had the 50 people. In 2 weeks, over 50 people had registered, word of mouth. Within a month, there were over 100 people. Within a year, there were about 1,000 people registered. Today, Ciencia Puerto Rico has members all over the world, and there are 6,500 people registered in the website. Most of these are scientists, Puerto Rican scientists, but there are other members as well, like I mentioned before, educators and students. So why was it so successful with essentially a shoestring budget and no marketing? There were a few things that I can pinpoint that we did right at the beginning. One of them is that we use social networking tools. So I think that social networking, scientific societies have existed for a long time, but social networking tools in scientific societies are underused. So we created social networking tools which were tailored for scientists, for educators, and that facilitated, that added value to people wanting to come and register and put in their information. The other thing that we did is that we defined the community based on the interest. So we were interested in attracting Puerto Rican scientists, but we didn't define the website for Puerto Rican scientists. We defined the website for people interested in science and Puerto Rico. And we did that on purpose because there are a lot of people that are not of Puerto Rican descent which might be interested in contributing to Puerto Rico. We wanted to attract those people to our website. But we also wanted to attract educators. We also wanted to attract entrepreneurs. We also wanted to attract students. So that also added value. Of course, most of the people that are interested in science and Puerto Rico are Puerto Rican scientists, and most of our membership, as I'm going to be showing you, are Puerto Rican scientists. And finally, we made it as participatory as possible. So we crowdsource content. We allowed people to write in the information as much as possible so that people will bring in their interest and add to the website. So who are these people? Who are these 6,500 people that are registering this website, and why are they registered? So here are some demographics. Most of our members are in Puerto Rico, but there are a lot of members also in the US and in Latin America. Actually, for that matter, our community is dispersed over 47 different countries around the world. We cover 48 states in the Union, over 160 higher education institutions in the United States. Most of our members are in academia, but we also have members in the public sector, lots of teachers, lots of educators from K-12. And most of our members are actually students. There's graduate students that are seeking advice looking to create mentorship relationships, looking to connect to each other, to exchange information. But we also have a lot of members which are professors. We have also members that are, as I mentioned before, science teachers. So, I mean, these are cold numbers. I just wanted to give you an idea of the demographics. So, but let me put some faces behind this project. These are the people that helped create the website. Some of these people originated the idea with me. Some of them run the website right now. There's 6,500 different stories in this website. I don't have time to go through all the collaborations, the new jobs that have been created thanks to this website, the content that we have created that didn't exist before. But I did want to focus on a few things which I wanted to mention here because they add value to the lives of the general public, of the lay public. So one of them is a collaboration that is based on this concept that I started with, which is that we learn from each other. So we learn from each other. For the people on our website, what that meant to them was that they could come online and they could create mentoring relationships. That added a lot of value to their lives, and it eventually adds value to your life because these professionals are growing. They're Puerto Rican professionals that are growing, learning from each other in this online community. But there's something that adds value that's more direct to your life, which is that through the website, some amazing things that we have never been able to anticipate front-end started to happen. Educators started collaborating with basic researchers to create new content that didn't exist before. That transformed into an initiative with the main Puerto Rican newspaper here, El Nuevo Día, which essentially created over 383 new newspaper articles that contextualize science to the Puerto Rican reality. Over 210 podcasts. Now, these articles were, and these podcasts were first produced here in Puerto Rico, but they have been picked up over Latin America and in Spain because they're essentially what they represent is Spanish content science, which we're lacking in general. So this initiative was very impactful. One of the things that we noticed from this initiative is that teachers started using these newspaper articles, and they were using it essentially to exemplify scientific concepts. And from that, we recognized, as scientists, as creators of knowledge, we recognized that there was an opportunity because that meant that the teachers were desperate, there were very few contextualized lessons. And one of the products that came from that realization is this book. This book is called Ciencia Boricua. It's the first book of its kind in Puerto Rico. I think it's one of the first in Latin America. And essentially what we did is that we did a call out for proposals to our white scientific community, and we said, can you please explain in a context-relevant manner to students and to the general Puerto Rican public why what you do is important? Can you contextualize it? Let me give you an example of the kind of essays that you will find here. Let's say you're a teacher and you want to discuss something as abstract as tectonic plate movement. You will probably start with a lesson like this. This here is Pangea. You might start talking about Pangea and the thesis ocean. Or you can follow one of the essays from this book written by two geologists, two Puerto Rican geologists that are currently in Oklahoma. This is based on real scientific research. And say Puerto Rico was born in the Pacific. Let me say that again. Puerto Rico was born in the Pacific. So how do they know that? Well, it turns out that Puerto Rico, we call it an island, but it's not an island. It's an archipelago. It's an archipelago of five different islands. But even the main island, which the Taínos call Borinquen, is an archipelago. So these are a bunch of islands that came together. And the oldest island in that group is what we today call Cabo Rojo. And Cabo Rojo is called Cabo Rojo, which in English means Red Cape, because of Sierra Bermeja, which is a hill that has this red sediment. That red sediment, it turns out, are fossilized microorganisms, which exoskeletons are red. Those microorganisms have never existed in the Atlantic. That part of Puerto Rico was an island that was born in the Pacific, and through tectonic plate movement, moved to the Atlantic, collided with other islands, and created what is modern day Puerto Rico. I will argue that example is far more memorable and context relevant than talking about a Pangea. You will find over 20 different essays like this in this book that contextualizes abstract concepts to the Puerto Rican reality here. So this book is also available as an ebook, and we started collaborating with schools to try to see if actually this worked. Does it matter? I mean, it's a nice book, it's a nice concept, but we're scientists. Are we really impacting education? So we did a study in a public school in Puerto Rico, and we observed that using this book increased by 47% the interest of students in learning context-relevant science. So this is actually a significant increase. It's a very important result. What this number doesn't tell you, though, are the stories behind the initiative. Essentially, it doesn't tell you about these students which for the first time met scientists in their lives. For the first time saw that there were scientists that looked like them. There were women scientists, there were Hispanic scientists. It doesn't tell you about the email that we received from the principal of that school telling us about how she came to the school on a Saturday. This is a public school in Puerto Rico. She came to the school on a Saturday, and there were a group of kids with this book sitting in front of the school discussing the essays. So I think this project that we did, I believe, could transform scientific education in Puerto Rico. In Puerto Rico, 3/4 of our kids are failing in science. They're scientifically illiterate. There's no way we can build a knowledge-based economy when 3/4 of our kids are failing in science. The scientists are willing and able to help with this. And by the way, I'm not trying to sell anything here. All of the initiatives that I've told you about are initiatives that are open source, are free. This is a nonprofit organization. So what we essentially did here through these initiatives is to connect brains online. This is something that scientists do all the time, but we did it with our community of Puerto Rican scientists by linking scientists, which are the producers of knowledge, with the main consumers of knowledge, which are students. So I'll tell you, I have told you already about how we learn from each other, how we use that concept to create this new initiative, how we then applied some, essentially this knowledge base of scientists to change scientific education in Puerto Rico, which we're continuing to do and trying to do. And I'd like to finish by telling you how we have learned is widely applicable. Essentially, we can apply these concepts to the rest of the world. Science is produced in a few select places. And if you were to redraw this world map based on scientific productivity, it would look something like this. So most of the communities over here, they also have scientists, but the scientists are not there. They have moved mostly to these regions, which means that the scientists from these communities are also residing in geographically dispersed communities. But because you're geographically dispersed doesn't mean that you cannot contribute to your community of origin. And that's what we showed in Ciencia Puerto Rico. So Ciencia Puerto Rico is a special community, but it's not a unique community. I show you how, essentially, we could promote scholarly interactions among a dispersed community of scientists, and also how we could support education initiatives. Although we're spread all over the world, we could support education initiatives that are impactful in real life here in Puerto Rico. And I will argue that the lessons that we have learned, if applied to other scientific communities around the world, could change the way that scientists communicate with each other, exchange information, relate to the general public, and impact scientific education around the world. Thank you.